Good morning, everybody. And apologies for a slightly late start. There was a few dress issues, but anyway, we won't worry about it. Please do be seated. It's lovely to be back with you. I hope that Michael looked after you well last week. And I also had a very enjoyable time away. So thank you for releasing me to be free. One or two notices. It's great. We managed to raise £550 for the flood victims in Ukraine. So thank you for that. It's lovely to be able to support needs wider than ourselves, but also the food bank does need your attention as well. If you can remember to try and bring something to church most weeks, that would really help. They are struggling for donations at the moment because so many people are in need. And actually, we can bless ourselves with coffee and cake at the chapel on Saturday, so I hope you will go and enjoy that. There is also the opportunity to go to the Life of Christ on Friday because a ticket has become available. If you're free on Friday and you fancy an outing, see Amanda, who will tell you all about it. It will be a shame to waste the ticket. And if you know of anybody who we could bless with a ticket, just let us know. So thank you. See Pew's News for the rest. I also have a suspicion, church wardens, I should be reading bans. I've just remembered.
Last week.
Yeah, I know, I need to do, yeah. So if somebody could get me the bans book, that would be very helpful. I don't have to do them at the beginning of the service, so we will start the service and I'll do them after the hymn, if that's okay. It's the joy of coming back, your mind isn't quite on it. Grace, mercy and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Now let's remind ourselves that we are part of the world and all people that on earth do dwell should sing to the Lord. So please stand and let's join in with this hymn. Please now be seated. So I published the banns of marriage between Billy Lee Chadwick and Evangeline Margaret Hamilton of the parish of Broad Heath between Aidan Bernard Robson and Laura Elizabeth Eccles of the parish of Christchurch Epsom, and Edward Nigel Ventum and Jordana Alice Simons of the parish of St Barnabas Southfield. This is for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. So now a short prayer for these couples. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of marriage, and we pray for these three couples about to enter into it, that you will bless them and prepare them, that they may have a life of commitment and love and joy as they celebrate their wedding and move on into married life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now we come to our prayers of penitence. So sit or kneel as we prepare to confess our sins. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy." My brothers and sisters, as we prepare to celebrate the presence of Christ in word and sacrament, let us call to mind and confess our sins. Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please now stand for the Gloria. Please remain standing for the prayer for the day, the collect. God, our Saviour, look on this wounded world in pity and in power. Hold us fast to your promises of peace, won for us by your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Now we'll have our first reading, please. Thank you.
The reading is taken from Romans 6, verses 1 to 11. What shall we say then? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may increase? By no means. We died to sin. How can we live in it any longer? Or don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Sarah. Please stand for the Gospel reading. The Gospel reading can be found in Matthew chapter 10, reading from verse 24. Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. This is Jesus talking. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebub, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever acknowledges me before others, I will also acknowledge before my Father in heaven. But whoever disowns me before others, I will disown before my Father in heaven. Do not suppose that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to turn a man against his father, a daughter against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be the members of his own household. Anyone who loves their father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves their son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Whoever does not take up their cross and follow me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Let's have a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, and for his teaching, and for the teaching of those who have been and are his disciples. So we pray now for the help and inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may become more faithful disciples. In his name we pray. Amen. Sorry about the rustling. It's due to the fact that I'm trying to be summer dressed. Please do be seated. My other, the black cassock, is wool, so it's a little warm. Right. It's great to be back, but I have to say my heart sank a little when I looked up the readings for today. They're not very cheerful, are they? You know, we could be called Beelzebub, we could be threatened by being killed, or we could be denied by Jesus if we deny him. We could be sent to hell if we slip up. All of that sort of stuff. And then, of course, there's the problem of who do we love? And so I felt I needed to think quite deeply about these passages. But part of what came across was family relationships are complex. I am going to become a mother-in-law in the autumn when my son gets married. So I researched that a bit about family life, as I'm sure that other people have done as well. Some nuggets. Somebody wrote, I decided never to make a fool of my mother-in-law because just leaving her to display her natural talents would do. One cannibal said to the other, I can't stand my mother-in-law. The other says, well, why don't you just eat vegetables? Anyway, back to scripture. You see, resting doesn't help my jokes. Jesus offers us some reassurance, of course, because God cares about the sparrows and knows about the hairs of my head. Actually, he must know more about me than some of you looking down. But this God will take care of me, and Jesus says twice, don't be afraid. Well, actually, the latter is a bit worrying because it presupposes that I might be afraid, doesn't it? But our two readings today are important, and they aren't all negative. They prompted me to think about discipleship, which is actually not about hoping for an easy life. It's a life of commitment and of surrender, of being dependent on God, not myself. Being a Christian is tough, not for the faint-hearted. God's grace, though, is there for us and is very much needed. So I'm going to start with Romans 6. It seems that Paul was writing to the church that had a group that thought they could live as they wished. They rightly believed, of course, they were saved by grace. Big tick. They were forgiven by grace. Yes. This grace is unlimited. Yes. But they justified continuing to sin by saying, we're giving God the opportunity to show us more and more grace. Paul is horrified and puts in a firm corrective. Grace is freely given, but shouldn't be abused. It's for a purpose. When we believe with our hearts and confess with our mouths that Jesus is our Lord and Saviour, we are changed. And Paul links this to baptism. Through grace, when we are baptized, we die with Christ to sin. We're no longer slaves to it. Christ died on the cross, bearing our sin, and his resurrection demonstrates the victory has been won. In baptism, we're united with Christ in both his death and resurrection. So we also have new life, a life set free from the power of sin. So we are free to be able to choose to reject sin. Therefore, argues Paul, we cannot live a life of sin and the new life of Christ. They are incompatible. We need to die to sin just as Christ did. But we have just had our confession. We do still sin. But the difference is we shouldn't be deliberately sinning. Sin should be less attractive to us as we glimpse the fullness of life in Christ, all that's offered to us. When we focus on that, that should motivate us. After all, as Paul wrote in Romans 3, sin is falling short of the glory of God. It's actually an inadequate and a poor way to live. And of course, there is the motivation of the great cost of our salvation and the great joy of reconciliation with God, having a relationship with him, knowing him. We're reminded not to be deliberately selfish in the light of Christ's selfless sacrifice. However, we should note, salvation is an ongoing process. We don't get changed magically overnight. It's a work of a lifetime. And actually, much of what we think of as sin is really about making mistakes, of being ignorant, perhaps, of what we should do, sometimes being confused over the right way forward, sometimes struggling to know what's right when options are limited. And we get weary too. We just go along with the crowd. But we are the beloved children of God, and we can know his love. So our hope is in his promises and in the eternal life he has given us. Our desire, on good days at least, should be to please him and to make Jesus our example of the perfect human life. So now to our gospel reading. I think these negative things are what Jesus basically has experienced and warns us that we could face opposition as we follow him. We're encouraged not to be afraid because we are loved and we have an eternal future. In particular, Jesus is saying, don't be afraid of what people say. They may falsely accuse us, but God knows the truth about us. And that's not to be scared of. I mean, sometimes you think, oh, God knows all about me. That's a bit frightening because, well, you know, I'm not perfect. But the point is, God will vindicate us as those who have tried to follow Jesus. We may have failed sometimes, but we've tried. We who are falsely accused or criticized for our faith or get things wrong will be okay. So we don't need to be afraid, because we belong to the kingdom of God. One thing we are to be afraid of, says Jesus, that's being destroyed in hell. But even that is no longer a problem, because the love of Christ, who is our righteous and merciful judge, is also our saviour. He has rescued us. The Bishop of Sialkot in India, which is our link diocese for Guildford, was at the clergy conference I've just come back to. It was an interesting sort of coming back from Spain to being with 200 of my colleagues for 3 days in Derbyshire. But this bishop was quite inspiring because he spoke of the persecution of Christians in India, how they couldn't get decent jobs, how they were vilified. Sometimes they had to leave their homes. But that did not deter people from following Jesus. They believed, and so they lived out their faith. And when they suffered, they could testify to experiencing the grace of God all the more powerfully. They weren't afraid, and we don't need to be either. Now, another slightly tricky part of our passage is Jesus tells us not to love our families more than we love him. And that second part of the phrase is important. It's good and important to love our family and friends, but it's also important to love God, and he's worthy of the full extent of our love too. I don't think Jesus is saying relegate your love of family and friends to a lower level, but rather elevate your love of God to the top tier. Love him as much as you love those really close to you. And yes, our families will need us, and sometimes they have to come first before church, never first before God. But the God of love and grace has given me those people around me, and his desire and will is that I should love them and care for them. The other difficult bit about family is family turning against us. I think Jesus here is warning us, but actually he's referring to a prophecy in Micah. And that foretold the coming of the Messiah and that it would be accompanied by upheaval and divisions. The old order would be changed, old loyalties disrupted, a new would be formed, new allegiances to Jesus and the new family of God, new relationships and ways of living. Families don't need to be torn apart by different beliefs. They sometimes are, which is tragic. But where there are divisions, we must pray for reconciliation and never stop loving. So, in summary, really, discipleship begins with receiving all that Jesus offers us by grace and responding in love, making him central to all we do. He gives us all the help we need to do that by the Holy Spirit, who develops within us both fruit and gifts, character and abilities, changes us so we gradually become more and more like Jesus. But our passages remind us of something. We are to love others as we are loved. And that does include telling others about Jesus. The love that offers opportunity by grace to be set free from slavery to sin and fear of death and judgment and enable people to become fully alive needs to be made known. And of course, we are to help and serve others, but I think sometimes that's easier than declaring we believe in Jesus. Jesus is our Lord and Saviour, and his call includes being witnesses as well as being servants. And it shouldn't matter what it costs. Fear of what others might think about us or label us or even do to us shouldn't put us off. I know it does, but let's try and resist that temptation. So today, take this opportunity, come to Jesus in worship, declare your love for him, receive again from him in Holy Communion, be reminded of his love and grace, and be changed by his Holy Spirit. And then let's go out for him into his world to serve and witness as he directs. No, the Christian life isn't always easy or comfortable, but the rewards are worth more than anything this life can offer us. Amen. So being a Christian is not the easiest thing in the world. And I'm going to ask you in the Creed to reaffirm your faith, to remind yourselves of what you believe. So please stand. Do you believe and trust in God the Father? Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ? Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting.
Amen. Please remain standing for our next hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind.
Oh, my.
Please now be seated and Anne will lead us in our prayers.
We call to you, Lord, at the dawn of the new day. We place into your hands family and friends, work to be done, decisions we shall make, obstacles we encounter, strangers who pass our way, and the service we shall offer. Disturb us, Lord, when we are too well pleased with ourselves, when our dreams have come true because we have dreamed too little, when we arrived safely because we sailed too close to the shore. Disturb us, Lord, when with the abundance of things we possess, we have lost our thirst for the waters of life. Having fallen in love with life, we have ceased to dream of eternity, and in our efforts to build a new earth, we have allowed our vision of the new heaven to dim. Disturb us, Lord, to dare more boldly, to venture on wider seas where storms will show your mastery, where, losing sight of land, we shall find the stars. We ask you to push back the horizons of our hopes and to push into the future in strength, courage, hope, and love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the renewal of the church in faith, love, and service, remembering all who have been called to take on the role of ministry at home and overseas. We pray for all who have dedicated their lives to helping us to know and love you more clearly, especially Sandra, in her work here at St. Michael's. The following is written outside St. Paul's Church in Covent Garden, also known as the Actors' Church. We extend a special welcome to those who are single, married, divorced, widowed, straight, gay, confused, well-heeled or down at heel. We especially welcome wailing babies and excited toddlers. We welcome you whether you can sing like Pavarotti or just growl quietly to yourself. You're welcome here if you're just browsing, just woken up, or just got out of prison. We don't care if you're more Christian than the Archbishop of Canterbury or haven't been to church since Christmas 10 years ago. We extend a special welcome to those who are over 60 but not grown up yet, and to teenagers who are growing up too fast. We welcome keep fit mums, football dads, starving artists, tree huggers, latte sippers, vegetarians, junk food eaters. We welcome those who are in recovery or still addicted. We welcome you if you are having problems, are down in the dumps, or don't like organized religion. We offer a welcome to those who think the earth is flat, work too hard, or don't work, can't spell, or are here because Granny is visiting and wanted to come to church. We welcome those who are inked, pierced, both, or neither. We offer a special welcome to those who could use a prayer right now, had religion shoved down their throats as kids, or got lost in Covent Garden and wound up here by mistake. We welcome tourists, seekers, doubters, and you. Father, we pray that we welcome all whom we meet and all who come here, and that through their worship with us or a chance visit during the week, they may be enriched by your love and compassion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Throughout the world, many thousands of people are suffering as a result of war, persecution, prejudice, natural or man-made disaster, neglect, human trafficking of men, women, and children, and the indifference of others to help. At the forefront of our thoughts are always the people of Ukraine. Almighty God, the Father of all humanity, turn, we pray, the hearts of all peoples and their rulers, that by the power of your Holy Spirit, peace may be established among nations on the foundation of justice, righteousness, and truth. Teach us to trust rather than doubt, to love rather than hate, to accept rather than hold suspicion. Lord, may justice flow like a river, reaching barren lands and sun-scorched deserts. Where people feel forgotten and hopeless, let your water of life comfort them. Where your children lie abandoned or abused, let your water of life protect them. And where communities suffer at the hands of prejudice, let your water of life shield them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who are unwell in body, mind, or spirit, especially those known to us. Lord Jesus, you are the master of life and death. Everything we have is yours, and we love you deeply. Just one touch from you restores the sick, heals the broken, and transforms the darkness. We ask that you be with all who are ill and in need of our prayers. May they know your presence, feel your power, and know your love. Lighten their darkness and give them courage. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Anne. Now please stand and we're going to greet each other with the peace. We are the body of Christ. In one spirit, we're all baptized into one body. Let us then pursue all that makes for peace and builds up our common life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let's share the peace.
Don't forget the people on Zoom, give them a wave.
Peace be with you. And now we're going to remain standing and celebrate that we have a holy God worthy of our praise as we sing, Holy, Holy, Holy is the Lord.
Holy, 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 holy
Please remain standing for the Eucharistic prayer. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed be God forever. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let's give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, you made the world and love your creation. You gave your Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Saviour. His dying and rising have set us free from sin and death. And so we gladly thank you, with saints and angels praising you and singing. We praise and bless you, loving Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as we obey his command, send your Holy Spirit, that broken bread and wine outpoured may be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. On the night before he died, he had supper with his friends. And taking bread, he praised you. He broke the bread, gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper was ended, he took the cup of wine. Again, he praised you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, we remember all that Jesus did. In him we plead with confidence, his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. Bringing before you the bread of life and cup of salvation, we proclaim his death and resurrection until he comes in glory. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Lord of all life, help us to work together for that day when your kingdom comes and justice and mercy will be seen in all the earth. Look with favour on your people and gather us in your loving arms. Bring us, with St. Michael and all the saints, to feast at your table in heaven. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, O loving Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Of course.
Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word and I shall be healed. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. For those whose usual custom it is to receive the bread and the wine are welcome so to do. If you prefer not to have wine, that's perfectly fine. Just keep your hands down at that point. And if you wish to come forward for a blessing rather than to receive, you're very welcome to do that, keeping your hands behind you.
Thank you.
Let's just pause for a moment, commit ourselves to Christ anew before we say the prayer after communion. Let's say together, Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Now please stand and we'll sing together our final hymn, asking God to make us a channel of his peace. Please stand.
So as to go, to be understood, as to grow.
Please remain standing for the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and his only Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and those you love this day and always. Amen. Well, do enjoy tea and coffee. Part of the joys of Christian, I think, of being Christian is our fellowship together. So if you can stay, do have a chat and enjoy each other's company. And let's go out in the world determined to love and serve the Lord as he has been so faithful to us. May we be faithful to him. Hope to see you all next week, but have a good week in the meantime. Go now in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.
Amen.